today for scripture is found in Proverbs, the 31st chapter, 10 through 31. And this is kind of a poetic flair about showing how a godly woman can find fulfillment in her home. A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it is still night. She provides food for her family and portions for her female servants. She considers a field and she buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her tasks. She sees that her trading is profitable, and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff, and she grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor, and she extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity, and she can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate.
Once again, happy Mother's Day. This morning, actually, hang on just a second. Before we get started, I want to take care of something. Just one second. I mean, you never want to forget, right? So this is... I sure hope I'm not interrupting church. that'd be funny. So I just wanted to take a second and wish you a happy Mother's Day. I know you're probably in church right now, so sorry if I've disturbed anything. But hey, it's like old times, right? All these folks are staring at me, so I should probably get back to the message. But I did just want to make sure I called you, because I'm a good son. That was touchy. Oh, sorry. Anyhow, I'll talk to you later. See you next weekend. Love you. Bye. There we go. Now that we've got all the important stuff taken care of today. So today is Mother's Day. So believe it or not, we're going to talk about mothers. I know. Crazy idea, right? But that's what we're going to do. If you want to know what passage of scripture we're going to be in, so you can kind of get there ahead of time before I get there, we're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 1. 1 Samuel chapter 1. So it's Mother's Day. We've been in the book of Romans. We're going to take a break from that today. Celebrate mothers, talk about mothers and all the things that mothers do and how we should take care of them and react to them and interact with them. And we're going to talk about one mother in particular here in just a moment. But I just have a question. When does a woman become a mother? That seems like an easy question to answer, right? First thought is, at birth, right? When the child is born. Okay. Is it at birth or is it at conception? When does a woman become a mother? Or does it even have to involve a physical... Is motherhood something much bigger than that? I would suggest that it is. In fact, I would suggest this, that motherhood is a posture of the heart and not just a production of the body. Does that make sense? Motherhood is a posture of the heart and not just a production of the body. Because we've all been around for more than 5 minutes, and you know that there are some women who give birth to a child who aren't mothers. Am I allowed to say that in church? And there are some women who have never given physical birth who are more motherly than our own birth mothers. Am I speaking truth this morning? Am I? No, okay. And so, while I think giving that physical birth does make you a mom, right, you can check that box, I think there are other ways to check that I'm a mother box as well. And so we're going to talk about some of that today. And it's kind of crazy leading up to this. It's been a really crazy week. First off, once again, just to clarify, no, we are not making a baby announcement this morning. And nor will we be making a baby announcement in the near future. But this week, on Facebook, I had two different people that I know that made baby announcements. One was a good friend of mine, been friends since junior high, we were college roommates, he and his wife announced they were finally pregnant. And that's such a wonderful thing. Another one, a former youth group kid, who's now married, announced that they are pregnant, which is just weird. If you've ever taught Sunday school or led youth group or worked with kids in general, when they have big life moments, you go, that's impossible. Little Jimmy, you're only supposed to be this big. How are you married and having kids? Well, it's the way it works. On the other side of things, yesterday in my hometown, there was a couple, Zach and Randy England, who had to bury their 2-year-old little boy. Like I said, it's been a crazy week. And so here today, we're going to talk about moms. And the story we're going to talk about has some up moments, it has some down moments, it has some difficult moments, but it also has some bright spots. So I want you to join me here in 1 Samuel chapter 1, starting with verse 1. Everybody with me? Okay. 1 Samuel chapter 1, starting with verse 1. It says, there was a certain man from Ramathaim, a Zuphite from the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, son of Jehoram, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. Cheryl, you're welcome. He had two wives, Elkanah, this guy named Elkanah. Everybody say Elkanah. He had two wives. Here we go, verse 2. He had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other was called Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. Year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and sacrifice to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh, or Hophni and Phinehas, where the two sons of Eli were priests of the Lord. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her, and the Lord had closed her womb. And because the Lord had closed her womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Elkanah, her husband, would say to her, Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? So let me do some quick clarification here. Because this might seem a little strange, but there's just a couple foreign things here for us. The first thing was, Elkanah had two wives. Now, this is not an approval of a multi-marriage, of having more than one wife at a time. It's just what it was, okay? So Elkanah had two wives. One was named Peninnah, one was named Hannah. Now, Hannah is listed first, which is interesting. We'll talk about that in a bit. And then Peninnah is listed second. Peninnah had children. Hannah did not. Now, we know that Elkanah was married to both women, and it came time for him to go up to the temple. Now, if you remember in our days of spending some time in the Old Testament, church was done a little differently back then. If you wanted to ask for forgiveness of sins, for instance, it was more than just a simple prayer on your own. There was more of a process involved. It was, I need to go to the temple, I need to bring the sin sacrifice, often a goat or a couple birds or, you know, something. Bring it, I give it to the priest kills the goat, the animal, whatever, on the altar, same altar, used for everybody. It burns, and then after there's a prayer made by the priest and the sacrifice is burnt, then the meat is portioned out. Some goes to the priest, some goes to the people who brought the animal. Everybody with me? I mean, to step up, anybody ever been to a barbecue? Okay, same sort of thing, okay? To bring your own meat to church day, okay? They bring this thing. So Elkanah goes up every year. That was what every family had to do. You would go, you would take this sacrifice for your family. You would, you know, pray that God would place all of their sins on this animal. They would kill the animal, burn it. The meat is portioned out, some to the priest, some to the family that brought it. And then they would all eat, right? In celebration of this newfound forgiveness. Year after year after year after year, Elkanah goes up. So, from what we can tell, he and Penina and Hannah, they've been married a long time. Long time. Year after year after year, they do this ritual. And it says eventually it got to the place where Penina was provoking Hannah. Why? Well, let me show you. In the scripture, we go back. Same verse, chapter 1 here. It tells us what might have been the reason. Verse 5, but to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he what? Loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. So, this every year, that Elkanah brings this animal, and then the meat's portioned out. He gives some to the priests, of course, as it's set apart, and then he gives some to Penina and her kids, but to Hannah, he gives twice as much because he loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. So from the get-go, and we know very little about Elkanah, we know very little about Penina. From the get-go, it seems that Hannah is the favorite. That Elkanah loves her, and he's at least sympathetic with her plight. Right? She can't have kids. And so Penina, she gets upset by this. Have you ever known a jealous woman? Don't point. It's not nice. So Penina seems to be a little jealous of all the attention, the affection, the extra that Hannah is getting. And so she uses the one point of leverage that she has, which is her kids. Hey, Hannah! Hey, I'm just going to drop the kids off. You want me to take care? Oh, that's right. You don't have any. Hey, Hannah. Hey, little Susie, she's doing great in school, man. She is at the top of her class. How are your kids ranked? Oh, that's right. You don't have... Little Jimmy, man, he is top of the football team. How's your kids? Oh, that's right. Year after year after year after year. And remember, in this culture, kids are seen as a blessing. And that's not true in every culture, but in this culture, they're seen as a blessing. And so it's a showing of God's favor upon this family. And so Penina, she, you know, is all excited, and she starts walking with a swagger and trying to put Hannah down, and eventually it gets to her. Hannah begins to weep all the time. She begins to stop eating. She is sorrowful. She is sunken in depression. She is upset. And Elkanah, he wants to help, like a good husband. He loves her. Scripture tells us that, right? So he tries to help. He's trying to do the guy thing. He wants to fix it. He doesn't know how to fix it. He says, honey, what's going on? Why are you crying? Why aren't you eating? Why are you downhearted? Aren't I enough? Is it something I did? Am I not husband enough to fill that void? He doesn't quite understand. But there are some things that only children can fill. But he's trying. And so one of the things that we have to remember is that mothers are human. Mothers are human. And I mean that in two different ways. The first way, and probably the one you haven't thought about, is that in this segment of scripture, there are two mothers mentioned, right? Peninnah and Hannah. Peninnah is a mean mom, but she's a mom nonetheless. But she's also been hurt. She's human. Maybe she feels like her husband doesn't love her the way that he loves Hannah. And then there is Hannah, who is very human, dealing with very human emotions. She's bitter, she's upset, she's mad, she's disappointed. She's dealing with all these different feelings of failure and inadequacy, feeling like her own body has failed her, that she's done nothing to merit this from God, and yet this is the situation she finds herself in. See, mothers are often commanded to produce with little thought about their own self-worth. Moms are asked to cook and clean and take care of and pick up and manage and orchestrate and drive. Many of us don't take the time to think about what's being invested back into mom. And when they're dealing with issues like this, that Hannah's dealing with, issues of infertility, remember, her heart wants to be a mom. Her heart is there, but her body just isn't. And unfortunately, in that day and age, they didn't have the medical technology that we have today. Did you know that today, in the United States, roughly 11% of women aged 15 to 44 during the childbearing years have trouble getting pregnant? 11%. So look around. One out of every 10 women trouble getting pregnant. And for those who do have trouble getting pregnant, it's not just that, but even today, with all the advances in technology that we have, it is incredibly expensive. If you want to, you can do the lesser expense and do drug therapy, but that's roughly $50 or more a month. That adds up over time. And in vitro fertilization, where they just blast a bunch of fertilized eggs inside of the woman with hopes that something takes hold, that's over $12,000. Anybody got 12 grand on them? Anybody? Yeah, probably not. This particular issue is kind of near and dear to my heart because we have, Rachel and I have people on both sides of our family that have been impacted by this issue. Infertility and difficulty getting pregnant. Mothers are human, and it takes an emotional and financial toll to be a mom, doesn't it? I've never been one, but I know. And so one of the things that the rest of us, whether we're kids, husbands, others, one of the things we have to ask ourselves is this: do we make them feel guilty or lovely? Do we make them feel guilty or lovely? Because here's the thing: moms are good jugglers, but they're not perfect. Anybody's mom perfect? Anybody who is a mom, did you do it perfectly? No. But both your parents and you did the best you could. Human. And sometimes we don't see the best you could, we see what you didn't. Well, I'm trying to take care of this, and that didn't happen because I was trying to take care of this. And we go, well, what about this? Why isn't this done? Say, well, I was trying to take care of this, and this, and then they called, and then this person started crying, and then this person stopped by, and then the cat ran out, and we said, well, what about this? Sometimes, in the effort to be a mom, they're made to feel less human, and so you have to ask yourself, do we make them feel guilty about their shortcomings? Or do we make them feel lovely, precious, wonderful? What are we putting back into mom? Here we go. Let's continue on with the story. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 9. Once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh at the temple, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest was sitting on a chair by the doorpost of the Lord's temple. In bitterness of soul, Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord. And she made a vow, saying, O Lord Almighty, if you'll only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever come on his head, will ever be used on his head. So Hannah, year after year after year after year after year, she puts up with this provoking. She's not able to have kids. We don't know for how long, but it seems to be a lengthy amount of time. They're making another trip to the temple, and during one of those trips to the temple, after the sacrifice has been made, they're eating, everybody's, you know, celebrating this thing. She's still upset, and it says she's in bitterness of the soul. Some of you have had moments like that where you're just... And she starts weeping and praying out loud, or weeping and praying, God, I'm your servant. This is killing me. Hear my prayer, hear my cry, give me a son, and I'll give him back to you. Like, that's all about, just please, give me a son and I will give him back to you. And no razor will be used on his head. Now, I know that's kind of a strange thing, but in those days, there was a group of people known as the Levites. They were the priests of the temple. And if you were going to take a Levite vow, a Levitical vow, there were a couple things that you had to abstain from. You couldn't touch dead things, you couldn't drink wine, and you weren't allowed to cut your hair. It was just part of the discipleship discipline process. And so, essentially what Hannah is saying here is, I'm giving him to the temple. I'm dedicating him to God. I am all in on this. God, if you bless me with a son, I will bless you with him in return. I will give him back to you. Just please fill this void in my soul. That takes baptism and infant dedication a step further, doesn't it? Yeah. Just give me a son. And so she proves our point here that mothers are giving. I'm not telling you guys anything new, right? You know this. Mothers are giving. Oftentimes, mothers are our first example of love and service. Even if mom never took us to church, she acted like Jesus, right? Service, love, provision, protection, support. Let's talk about giving for just a minute. Oftentimes, we have no idea how much moms give. Like, let's just talk about feeding for a moment. Okay? Little person's born, right away, needs to be fed. And so moms, if they breastfed, of course, that they're literally giving of their bodies to this little life right away. And maybe they weren't able to do that, and so they decided to pump. And so every 4 hours, they had to pump and pump and pump and pump and pump and pump. And pump. Because believe it or not, kids want to keep eating. Crazy. Or maybe, moms didn't do that at all and they just did the formula thing, which is cool, that's fine, but you still got to make it. And I don't know if you've looked lately, but formula is stinking expensive. So there's mine, give it again. Time, energy, money, effort. That's just food. And as the kids get older, they only eat more. We often don't know the depth of a mother's giving. Hop back to this. Took too long earlier, so we got to keep going. Verse 12. As she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk and said to her, "How long will you keep on getting drunk? Get rid of your wine." "Not so, my Lord," Hannah replied. "I'm a woman who is deeply troubled. I've not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I've been praying here out of my great anguish and grief." Eli answered, "Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you've asked of him." She said, "May your servant find favor in your eyes." Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Early the next morning, they arose and worshipped before the Lord and went back to their home at Ramah. Elkanah lay with his wife, Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. So in the course of time, Hannah conceived and gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, saying, "Because I asked the Lord for him, he heard me." Good stuff. Right? Answered your prayer. Notice that when Hannah prayed, there was no heavenly voice from above that said yes. She had no guarantee that God was going to answer her prayer. In fact, the only thing that she heard was Eli the priest saying, "Woman, are you drunk?" Because she's praying, right? She's in the moment, she's praying. Now in words, I prayed like that before. But not speaking out loud, Eli thought she was drunk. Thought she had lost it. She said, No. I'm deeply troubled. I'm praying to God. Just hear me out. I'm not a wicked woman. I'm in the moment here. It's like, okay, God bless you. Go on about your day. She goes home, lays with Elkanah, get pregnant. And then she names the little man, the little boy, Samuel, which means the Lord heard me. Which I think is incredibly interesting because as we're reading through 1 Samuel chapter 1, there are at least two instances where she was not heard. Elkanah, aren't I enough for you? Well, that's not really the issue, Elkanah. And Eli obviously didn't hear her and misunderstood her again. Is that, are you drunk? And yet God heard her through all of her pain and all of her misery. Here's the truth. Mothers are often misunderstood. You ever seen a mom and you ask yourself, what is she doing? Maybe you're Walmart. Why is she doing it that way? Why is she acting that way? Why is she behaving? Why is she wearing pajama pants? What is going on? Moms are often misunderstood. Anybody parent exactly like your mom did? Nope. Anybody parent exactly like your neighbor does? No. And so there's often ways that we get misunderstood, right? We do things differently. We handle things differently. We approach parenting a little differently. All of us do. So moms are often misunderstood. My own mother, that'd be nice, she's coming next week, so I gotta be nice. My own mom, when I was little, she was very involved in singing, still is, at church. And so oftentimes when we were little, she would call us up on stage. I've told you this before. She'd have us come up on stage, and we'd sing specials with mom. And we'd practice at home. So, you know. Right? I'd stand beside mom. And
I sing my little songs. And a lot of people look at me. Mom said to do it. So I'm going to
even though there were a lot of people expecting me to be cute and awesome at the same time. And then as I got older, Mom, you know, still keeping us involved with stuff, and y'all sing a song with me. Okay, whatever. So we have to practice. I hate practicing. I don't want to practice, Mom. I got stuff I want to do. Games I want to play, TV to watch, friends to hang out with, right? I don't want to spend time practicing. We gotta practice, so we practice at home, and we do it on Sunday, even though everybody is watching, everybody expects me to be cool and awesome at the same time. I said, you know, when am I ever going to be up on stage singing in front of people? Mom had this way. She's a very detail-oriented person, and so she was very involved with church and different things. And so one of the things that she was involved with was a lot of kids stuff growing up. I just remember a lot of stuff. So like Vacation Bible School, she would make these huge like set pieces and decorations and all sorts of stuff, and just to try and make the event as awesome as it could be. And it didn't matter if it was VBS or if it was like a Valentine's Day dinner or, you know, whatever. There was just so much different stuff. And she would spend a lot of time working on this stuff just to make it as incredible as it could be. And you know, oftentimes we would get involved and we would help out at home. And I'm sitting there with Mom, and, you know, we're cutting out and coloring in a big, giant saxophone out of a piece of poster board. When am I ever going to make huge set pieces or care about decoration? Moms are often misunderstood. And oftentimes they're right. So I just want to put this out. What other people miss, God hears. When other people misunderstand, God hears. When life is a wreck and you can't get up the energy because the kids are screaming, the husband's not there, there's no food on the table, there's no money, there's no time, your parents have abandoned you, life is crazy, you can't take, you don't have the energy to put clothes on, so you just roll into Walmart in your pajamas. And a lot of time, people don't understand, but God hears. When things are so hard, and you and your husband are all the time, everything's scary, and you don't know what's going to happen, and so you know, somebody asks how you're doing, you say, I'm fine. And you go home and think, boy, I shouldn't have snapped at them. But then they go off to coffee and they say, did you hear about Louise? She snapped at me. All I said was, how are you doing? When people miss it, when people misunderstand, God hears. He hears through all the craziness. He hears through all the pain. He hears through all the misery and the chaos. So Hannah gives birth to his son and he's saying, let's finish it up. Here we go. Verse 21. When the man Elkanah went up with all his family to offer the annual sacrifice to the Lord and to fulfill his vow, Hannah did not go. She said to her husband, after the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always. Do what seems best to you, Elkanah, her husband told her. Stay here until you wean him, only may the Lord make good his word. So the woman stayed at home and nursed her son until she had weaned him. After he was weaned, she took the boy with her, young as he was, along with a three-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. When they slaughtered the bull, they brought the boy to Eli, and she said to him, as surely as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I asked of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given over to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. So it comes time for that annual trip back to Jerusalem, or back to Shiloh, excuse me. And they're loading up the camels. And Elkanah says, Hannah, come on. I said, well, I'm not going. What do you mean you're not going? I've been warming up the camel for 5 minutes. No, I'm not going. I'm going to wait till Sam is weaned, and then I'll take him up there myself. Okay. Does your camel have a car seat? Yes. Okay. So after the boy is weaned, and he can survive on real people food, Hannah loads up and takes off to Shiloh. Now, did you notice all the stuff she's taking with her? Not only is she taking a little man who demands attention, named Samuel, but she takes a 3-year-old bull, bag of flour, some wine. Some things never change. Moms are always hauling extra stuff, right? Always. Whether it's in their purse or their car, just what moms do. So she gets to the temple. And she had talked with Elkanah. She said, look, he's going to go. I'm going to offer the sacrifice, and I'm going to leave him there. I'm going to fulfill my promise to God. Elkanah, being the loving husband that he is, says, you do what's best, honey. May the Lord be true to his word, be good to his word. Essentially, what that means is, God help you, because I know this is going to be hard. She hasn't had this baby for very long, but she made a promise. Here's the last little tidbit. Mothers are loving. Mothers are loving. Hannah loved God, her provider, the Lord, as she refers to him. Which, by the way, she also refers to Eli as Lord, lowercase L, if you're reading along. That's just a term of respect, so it'd be like sir, okay? When you see Lord in all capital letters in the Old Testament, that is actually added in by the editors, because what Hannah actually said was the name of God, Yahweh. But when they were writing it, they weren't actually allowed to write the name of God. They considered it too holy, and so they would plug in the word Lord instead. There's your fun fact for today. Hannah was loving, and so she knew that she had made a promise to God, and therefore the best thing for her son was to let him go. That's a hard thing to do. Yesterday, my wife and I went to a birthday party, and at the birthday party, our son is running around. There's an outdoor playground. He's running around, right, just like hitting space. Where he could fall, his head could break like a watermelon. He needs my hand on his rope to make sure he climbs safely. Give him space. All right. Mothers are loving. How if we love them? Moms do a lot for us, and there's never a guarantee that they'll get anything back. Hannah gave up her son without a guarantee that she was going to get anything back. And yet, if you look towards the end of chapter 2, it says the Lord gave Hannah 3 sons and 2 daughters. Beyond Samuel. So where do you find yourself in this story? Are you a child? And you need to thank mom for all that she's given to you, all that she's done? Are you aware of how many times mom has had to sit at a recital or a baseball game? Or sit up, take you to practice when she'd rather be at home in the tub soaking? Are you an outsider? And one of the things that you have to do, one of the things you should do, is just hang out with mom. Whether it's your mom, whether it's somebody else's mom, whether it's a young mom, whether it's a mom who lost a child, whether it's a mom who just can't have children, they need your love and support. And if you're a mom today, well, thanks. God, we thank you for giving including us mothers, biological or not, who have poured so much into us. Love and attention, support, encouragement, advice. And Father, we often don't take time to pour back into them. And so maybe one of the things we need to do is just sit down and talk with them. Maybe we haven't done that in a while. Maybe we need to thank them for all the things that we took for granted growing up. But now we realize just how important they were. Father, we thank you for this love, example of love and service that you've given to each of us. We thank you most of all for Jesus. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. So, if you are a lady who is over the age of 18, okay, there are a couple in here, just barely squeaked over the age of 18. If you're a lady who's over the age of 18, so 18 to 106, 106 is the cutoff. At that point, you probably can't see anyway, so it doesn't matter if you get flowers, right? If you're a lady from 18 to 106, we have a present for you, a gift, as Cheryl mentioned, some flowers. And so whichever direction you go, whether you go that door, that door, that door, please be sure to pick up a flower. It's our way of saying thank you for all that you do, all that you've done, and all that I'm sure you will do. If our students would help with, you know, handing those out, there will be a couple of the spiritual life ladies at each door as well. So, after you get your flower, head next door, women, and the men are going to take care of everything. We're going to make sure you get your refreshments and are as comfortable as possible. So, thank you very much. Happy Mother's Day. Have a good one.